We'll start the class today with 3 ohms. Sahana bhavato, sahanau bhunaktu, sahaviryam karavavahai, tejasvinavadhitamastu mavittishavahai. Om shanti, shanti, shantihi. So we are in the new text called Drik Drishya Viveka. I have given a full introduction to this text last week, in the last Saturday. And broadly speaking, this text consists of 3 sections. The first section is the actual text telling us what is Atma and what is Anatma. What is Drik, which is called as the seer, and what is the Drishyam, which is the seen. Then the second section is 6 meditations are talked about. It's a very beautiful subject where a very in-depth knowledge has been given about meditations. The third section is talking about 3 types of jivas, which means 3 levels of our existence. Our existence in the Vyavaharika plane, then our existence in the dream, and then the final existence in our own self. And then I gave you all the different topics which are to be covered. Today we are going to see topic 1, which is verse 1 to 5, the 3 types of Drik, which is the 3 types of seers. If we have time, we will move on to topic 2, which is verse 6 to 12. This is a beautiful section which talks about how this entire world is seen by the consciousness through the medium of the mind and the sense organs. So now we will go into the first section, which is the which deals with the 3 types of seers. The first verse is a very important verse in the whole text, because this gives us a beautiful explanation about how we all function in this world. All these 5 verses in the first topic are important verses. The first verse says, Rupam Drishyam Lochanam Drik. What it means is the eye is the seer, and the form and color are the seen. Then the second part of this is the eye is the seen and the mind is the seer. And the third part is the witness is the seer. Witness here means the consciousness. He is the seer of the mind, and the consciousness, being the ultimate seer, can never be seen. So the first verse introduces us the 3 seers. Number 1, the sense organs. Number 2, the mind. and number three, the consciousness. What is the benefit of knowing this? The benefit of knowing this is we get a clear understanding of how we are all consciousness principle and not the body or mind. So this is the aim of this text. The aim of this, purpose of this text is to tell us or to teach us how I can separate the body, mind, world from consciousness. It will reveal the nature of Atma, which is consciousness itself. It will tell us what is the connection between consciousness and the body-mind complex. It will teach us the ego I and the real I. And by claiming ourselves to be the real I, which is the Atma, we can get moksha. Moksha means freedom from the identification with the body and mind as me. So this is broadly how this text is beautifully designed, and the author of this text is Swami Vidyaranyas from the Shankara Matham in Sringeri in South India. He was the first Acharya, the teacher. So Shankaracharya established different schools in India, north, south, east, west, and then he said, he put four of his disciples as the teachers in the four schools. And then the whole of India got the knowledge, the Vedic knowledge. The Vedic knowledge is extremely useful and is a very unique knowledge, because the way it looks at the world is very, very different than how we normally, as human beings, look at this universe. Our thought patterns will change as we gain this knowledge. The way we look at our relationships, the way we look at our problems, all this will change as we learn more and more the Vedas. So the seer, as I said, is the first seer is the sense organs, and the second seer is the mind, and the third is the consciousness. And what is the seen? The seen is the world of objects. And they are called as experienced. Experiencer is consciousness. Experienced is the world. Experienced is inert matter. Experiencer is sentient consciousness, awareness principle. This awareness principle is invisible, whereas the body, mind, sense organs are either directly visible to all of us, or the mind, for example, is known only to us. This verse basically draws attention from a Keno Upanishad mantra, which talks about how the sense organs are functioning in the world. And this mantra the disciple is asking his guru, and he says, how, on what basis, who is the one, what is the principle which directs the mind? What is the principle which directs the prana? That means, who is responsible for the prana, that the inhalation and exhalation process? How does it function? Who is behind it? Then the third question the student asks is, what is behind the speech? What intelligence directs the eyes? Who is behind the eyes? Who is behind the mind? Who is behind the speech? Who is behind the pranas? The answer to that question, as you all know, is the pure awareness or consciousness. This pure awareness, consciousness, through the Maya Shakti. Maya Shakti means there is a power which this consciousness has through that power, it projects this entire universe. And then for the jivas, it gives the entire landscape to perform actions and draw merits and demerits as per their prarabdha karma. Now, can consciousness directly illumine the sense organs? No. This is how the Vedas, they say that consciousness cannot illumine the sense organs directly. For example, if we are all sitting in a class and I'm sitting in the first desk and you are somewhere in the fifth desk, if I want to lend a book to you, I can come directly and give you the book, or through somebody in between, I can lend the book through Uma or through Shama or anybody. So, consciousness does not directly illumine the sense organs and the world. It illumines the mind first. So, as soon as you get up in the morning, the first thing which we see is the mind, which we come aware, we become aware of the mind first. And then, once the mind is illumined, immediately all our sense organs are illumined. Our eyes get the power. It's like the main switch of the of our house, electric switch, you know, the main power switch. So the power switch is what? The mind. And then all other rooms get lit, that is, the sense organs get lit by the mind. And then the sense organs illumine the world. We will be studying more deeper of this approach in the next 10 verses, how this whole process happens. This is the main first verse, which gives a broad guideline as to how Swami Vidyaranya wants to teach us about consciousness. So the mind and the sense organs are the intermediary, giver and receiver. They receive the power from the consciousness and then they give it to the world or to the sense organs. Mind gives it to sense organs give it to the sense objects. Now, how does this happen? If you ask, there is another example in the Vedas, they give this example of the moon and the sun. This is explained in another verse also. As we study, we will see the more details of this. So the moon, if you ask, does it have light of its own on a Purnimi day, on a full moon day? If you see that the earth is illumined by the moonlight, but the moonlight, does it belong to the moon? A normal lay person will say, yes, it is the moonlight which illumines the earth. But a wise person will think and say, no, the light of the moon does not belong to the moon, but it is reflected light of the sun. The sunlight reflects on the moon, which is the matter principle, and then the moon reflects the earth. So similarly, consciousness is like the sun, which is always there. But the mind wakes up, goes to sleep, like the moon comes up, goes down. So when the mind is up, we see the entire sense organs are illumined and then we see the world. When the mind is gone to sleep, like the moon is off from the direction of the sun, what happens is, we experience deep sleep. But consciousness, like the sun, is always there. Only thing what happened is the moon has come and gone, the mind has come and gone. And how does the mind function? It always functions in the form of thoughts. We must remember this point very, very well whenever we are studying any spiritual text. The mind is made up of thoughts, vritti. Once, only when you know it is made up of thoughts, you will then realize that I am different than the thoughts. I, the illuminator, the consciousness principle, am different from my mind. So Jivatma, as we have studied in Tattva Bodha, consists of three bodies: gross, subtle, and causal. Five koshas, all of you know the five koshas, so I won't repeat it. Now we are going to see from verse number 2 to 5, a detailed commentary on the first verse. So the entire introduction portion 1 to 5 consists of the three seers, and these three seers are explained in verses 2, 3, 4, 5. Now the second verse talks about the sense organs. The sense organs, are the first seer, the seer number 1. Then the seer number 2 is the mind. Seer number 3 is the sakshi. So 2, 3, 4 explains the three seers. In the second verse, the author says that the forms are many. Suppose you take the eyes. The eyes see red color, blue color, green color, and so many different colors. It sees so many different forms. You see mountains, you see rivers, you see so many different forms and colors. That is a function of the eyes. So what he says is, the eyes are one, they remain as the same, but the objects, the sense objects, the forms are many and varied. And similarly for the ears, different types of sounds, for the skin, different types of touch, but the skin doesn't change, the ears don't change, the tongue doesn't change, we taste different foods. Similarly, we smell different flavors, perfumes, but the sense organs don't undergo any change. The sense objects keep on changing. Then behind the sense organ, there is the mind, which perceives the sense organs. Can the sense organs see sense objects without the mind? No. In a later example, in a later pages, we'll see why they can't see, why we can't, why without the sense mind, sense organs cannot see the sense objects. As we have seen in Tattva Bodha itself, the coordinator for all these five sense organs is the mind. Without a coordinator, the moment we wake up, we see the forms, we see the colors, at the same time we hear sounds, we hear the birds chirping, and then we hear the alarm, this, you know, and we see so many things. All the five sense organs are being seen or being perceived by the mind. One mind sees the five sense organs. And ultimately, what is the absolute seer, which is not ever seen, but it is ever the seer, is consciousness. Consciousness has no limitations and no differences. Limitations means Desha Kala Vastu. This is what is called as Anantaha. Anantaha, today we'll see in meditation one term being used called Anantam. Satyam Jnanam Anantam. Anantam means there is no limitation of time for consciousness because it is beyond time. There is no limitation. Consciousness is not, does not only pertain to only Singapore or India or Australia or New Zealand, but it is everywhere. It's all pervading. That means it is not limited by the place, not limited by the time. At any time, you are conscious. All the time, you're conscious. There's no time when you're not conscious. Your body may be seen, may not be seen, mind may be seen, may not be seen, but objects in the universe may be seen, but you, the consciousness, never have any change. You're always there, ever evident. Then, in consciousness itself, there is no difference. That means there are not two consciousness, like we can see two trees. If I look outside the window and I see a tree, there's another tree out next to it, but in consciousness, there is only one consciousness in the entire universe. That difference is called as sajatiya bhedaha. In the Sanskrit, difference amongst itself, that means difference in itself. Like no two trees or no two birds, but it is one consciousness. Vijatiya means what? Different species. Jati, different. Vijatiya, that means, for example, tree and stone, they are two different substances. That is called differences between two different species. But consciousness being one, there are no differences because it doesn't have a second one. There is no second in consciousness. That is why we always say it's Advaitam. Not two, only one. Then Swagata Peda. Swagata Peda means like a tree has got leaves, fruits, branches, trunk, different parts. It doesn't, consciousness doesn't have any part. There is no portion, there's no head portion for consciousness, there's no leg portion for consciousness. Therefore, consciousness being one non-dual is an absolute seer. Seer also means it is the hearer, it is the feeler, perceiver. It's one principle. And that is akhanda kara vritti. That means it is one non-dual seer. There is no, it is one, there is no second seer, there is no different seers in as far as consciousness is concerned. So the first verse talks about the sense organs being the first type of seer. The second seer is given in verse number 3. Same principle, mind remaining the same, it knows the different characteristics of the eyes, the ears, the tongue. Different characteristics. For example, if the eyes are sharp and clear, when you go to a optometrist, when you see optologist, what happens is he will ask you when you want to get a new specs. He'll say, "Well, can you see clearly?" "Yes, I can see letter A, but I can't see letter Z." Then he'll put another glass and he'll show you and he'll say, "No, I can see everything better." So the perception of the eyes is seen by the mind behind. So the mind is behind. Similarly, the ears. Behind the ears is the mind. So different perceptions of the eyes, ears, the tongue, are known by the mind. So different the perceptions may be many, but the mind behind them, which is the real seer of the sense organs, is one. It remains the same. This is with reference to the sense organs. When it comes to the mind itself, it becomes again relative. So the mind and the sense organs both are called as relative seers. Just now we saw that the sense organs are seeing the objects outside, which are drishyam. The third seer is explained in verse number 4. So we have seen sense organs seeing the sense objects. We have seen the mind seeing the sense organs. Now we are going to see who sees the mind. All of you know the answer. Consciousness remaining the same sees the different thoughts. It knows the different thoughts of desire, of will, doubt, belief, disbelief, all the fears, jealousy, compassion, joy, sorrow, all different conditions, emotions of the mind are ultimately known to us. So what is the factor, what is the principle which sees, which knows the mind? It is the consciousness. See how brilliantly the teacher takes us from the gross world to the intimate world of passions and emotions, and ultimately to the seer of the knower of the passions. In four verses, the author has done a remarkable job of trying to reveal this Atma, this consciousness, this light in us, which reveals the whole universe to us. The cognitive conditions are called, of the intellect, are called as ignorance, doubt, knowledge, or understanding. And in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, this 10 conditions of the mind are beautifully explained. This is the actual verse. People who are interested can go to the actual Upanishad and see. But this verse, is taken from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. And it tells us there are 10 conditions of the mind. The first one is the desire. I have a lot of desires. I know I want to go to a shop. I want to go and buy. I want to buy vegetables today. I want to buy a car today. It is known. The desires are known by whom? It is known by the consciousness. I want to plan to build a house. I want to implement a desire. That is also known. Then I start working towards it. Then I have certain doubts whether I should implement the plan or not implement. Then I have faith in God. Don't have faith in God. Both are the thoughts in the mind. It is not me, the consciousness. So if somebody doesn't believe in God, don't blame him. I mean, he has got a mind. The mind has got this thought. That's all. But he is not the mind. He is consciousness. So this is how we should, when we relate to the world, we should know how to deal with people. In the transaction field, yes, we'll have to go as per the circumstances. But if you really want to know the truth, this is how we should realize the nature of consciousness. That is, lack of faith is also a condition of the mind. Willpower, perseverance. Some people you will find that they are so deep and they are so strong in their willpower. Whatever may be the obstacles, they are going forward. They are taking the next step, the next step, the next step. They are undaunted. They always are one single pointed towards their goal. It can be in education. They want to do a PhD. They want to become a doctor. It can be in the field of sports. They want to be an Olympic champion. It can be in the field of arts. They want to draw a beautiful painting. Any field. They want to be the best at it. That willpower is a condition of the mind. And it is known. It's not that it is not known. Who is behind it? It's the consciousness. The lack of willpower, the opposite of it, the diffidence. I don't have the willpower to go get up in the morning at 5 o'clock and go for a jog or go for a walk. That is also known to us. I lack something. Again, it is a mind. Shyness. I'm very shy to speak in public. Modesty. This is also known to us. I have knowledge about the satellite launched by the US NASA called Perseverance last week. They have launched a beautiful satellite which is going to land on Mars. So I have the knowledge, I don't have the knowledge. I am ignorant about so many things. I don't know so many things. This is again the mind. Fear, lack of fear, fearlessness. This is also the mind. So, see how the Upanishad go and study the various conditions of the mind and how they have revealed that consciousness is the knower of these conditions. The author has just picked up the essence from the Upanishads and is constructed this text. And he is trying to reveal in 46 verses the nature of consciousness, which lies behind the mind. So this is the beautiful mantra which talks about all the conditions in the mind: faith, steadiness, unsteadiness, shame, intelligence, fear. All these are explained in the Brihadaranyak Upanishad. Brihadaranyak Upanishad is supposed to be the biggest Upanishad. So generally people don't even study this Upanishad because it's got so many. It's the biggest. I don't know exactly how many mantras. If you look at my website, you will find the exact number of mantras in this Upanishad. And it's a very deep and a very, very knowledgeable text. Okay. Body is identified with the organ of speech, with the mind and the vital force. It's the body which gets identified with the prana. Prana, apana, samana, udana. It's a body. So if we are absent-minded, we don't see form or hear the sound. Many times, sometimes in class itself, suppose you are attending this class and suddenly you remember, I didn't even close my car. I forgot to lock my car. And then your mind starts wandering towards the car. Did I lock the car or did I not lock the car? Or suppose you say, okay, what I'm going to eat today in the dinner? So the mind is already, is not behind the sense organs, the ears. So it doesn't hear the class. So this is why we say that there is some factor called as the mind. It shows the existence of the mind apart from the consciousness and the sense objects. Consciousness makes them knowable without changing itself. Very important point. Like the mind doesn't change for all of us, it doesn't change with respect to the sense organs. Every day we get up, every day it perceives through the sense organs the external world. Similarly, the mind itself changes, but the consciousness behind it doesn't change. So this seer number three, which is the ever experiencer principle in us, it is never experienced. Therefore, we don't have to look for the experience of Atma. We must have the knowledge that I am Atma. I repeat again and again this particular point, because many a times, people are trying to objectify Atma, which they will never succeed, and they will ever say, I have not realized my Atma, therefore, I have not seen my Atma, therefore, I am not a realized person. So this notion should be dropped. We can never experience is always to do with the mind. But Atma is beyond the mind. It's not a part of the mind. It is an independent entity which pervades the mind like the light pervades the hand. And then it survives when the mind becomes passive in sleep. I'm still there in sleep, but the mind has gone to sleep. Mind has become passive. So we must differentiate the sense objects, the sense organs, the mind, and consciousness. This is how the structure of the human being with reference to the world is explained by this author. What about consciousness? Does it have any other light to illumine the consciousness, anything behind the consciousness? No. It is self-evident. It is ever there, that's all. Ever there, eternal. So by knowing this consciousness, what happens to me? I become immortal. I say I am immortal because I don't identify myself with the body mind as me. That's all. Entire Veda study, entire Vedanta is only to change our conclusion about us. Today, without knowledge, I have concluded that I am the body and mind. What Vedanta says is, your conclusion is wrong. It's an intellectual conclusion, which is a misconception. Vedanta does not change the external world for us. It does not change the body. It does not change the mind. It only changes the conclusion in the intellect of who we are. This point must be very clear, because throughout the study, we should not expect any changes to happen in the body, any changes to come in the mind in a very direct way. But what will happen is, I will know my mind better. That's all. I will know the conditions of my mind because I have learned to see my mind, know my mind better. This is the greatest gift of the study of Vedas. I know how to handle my mind. I know how to face my mind. Then I have situations which I can't control. These situations, the changes in the mind come to me because of prarabdha karma. It's got nothing to do with me. It is the nature of the universe. It is a law of karma. Then the changes happen in my mind. As for the changes of karmic law or changes in the body, as per karmic law, I know how to face it, because I create a distance between me, the body, me, the consciousness, and the body and the mind and the world. Okay, what is the nature of this consciousness? The nature of this consciousness is very well explained here. It does not rise. It is not born. This is Bhagavad Gita. Na jayate mriyate va kadachit. Verse number 20 of the chapter 2 of the Bhagavad Gita. Atma is never born. I, the Atma, am never born. The body is born. The mind gets reflected when the body is born. It does not increase or decay. The body may grow from 5 kilos or 2 kilos to 50 kilos, but the consciousness remains the same, which gets reflected in the mind and the body. Consciousness shines by itself and it illumines others without any aid. Just now I said it doesn't have another consciousness. Is there any other principle in the universe which is making the consciousness known to me? No. Consciousness is self-evident. It is the ultimate light of all lights. It's never born, but it exists eternally. This is what we should see the difference between existence and appearance. These two words, you must remember you must know the difference between the two. Because Vedanta depends a lot on these two words. The world is an appearance. It comes and goes. Mind is an appearance. Comes and goes. Conditions comes and goes. The three states are appearances. Comes and goes. The only thing which exists is consciousness, awareness, changeless. It is not born, does not originate like the body or the universe. Universe also comes and goes in deep sleep. I don't experience the universe. This consciousness is not destroyed. It does not die. These are all from the same verse of the Bhagavad Gita. Again, the author has borrowed this from Either the Upanishads is there in Kathopanishad also, the same mantra. So what it says is the conditions of the different aspects of consciousness are being described in this. The origination of reflected consciousness is there in a newborn baby. Like when a mirror is born, when a mirror is in front of me, when there is no mirror, there is no reflection. But suppose somebody brings a mirror in front, you can see the reflection automatically. So similarly, what happens? The baby is a gross material body being born. The moment the baby has the ability to reflect, to bring in the mind, it gets the consciousness gets reflected in the mind of the baby. So reflection of consciousness originates when the baby is born with the mind. The science says there is no original consciousness. According to science, consciousness is a part, is a function of the brain. But Vedanta and scriptures, they have a totally different view of consciousness. So science believes only in reflected consciousness, but Vedanta says there is a consciousness which existed before the Big Bang. So miles away, the entire two philosophies, two concepts. It existed before the creation itself. That means it is changeless. What it means is that it is, there's one factor which has not changed. That is the main reason we are all feeling that I don't change. I am always there, eternally there. And even though you can see the energy is in motion, rapid motion, all the atoms, elements, the earth is moving at so many thousand miles per hour, but still I don't move because I am this eternal consciousness without any movement, without any change. It is self-evident, I've explained this, the mind rises and falls, the time and space are born in it. Therefore, we say we are immortal. We means I, the consciousness, is immortal. So the threefold seers, the mind and sense organs, have got the birth and death. They become sentient, they become insentient. They are formed in time and space, whereas consciousness ever is. It is never born. And consciousness lends its power to the mind and the sense organs. This lending concept is what happens when the baby is born. It lends. That means the baby at the time of birth itself, the conscious reflection gets in, and the jiva is born in that body. The waking time and space are a part of the waking experience. This is what Vedanta says, that in sleep there is no time, waking time. We are asleep, means there is no waking time. That means the time and space are a part and parcel of only this universe. Say today, for example, it is today has gone. Yesterday it has come and gone. One package has come and gone. But the Karana Shariram is a different level of consciousness. The dream experience is a different level of consciousness. It is not a part of the waking time, waking world. Every dream lasts only for 90 seconds. So 90 seconds, we see a world, a complete world. 90 seconds. So it's a different realm. Similarly, Karana Shariram, the subtlest matter principle, is another seed form of this entire universe. But consciousness is beyond time, beyond the Karana Shariram. It is timeless. At the same time, it is immanent. When we say timeless, the word used is transcendental. When we say the consciousness is immanent, it means it is there, it is also there in time. So there is one principle which exists in time and also exists beyond time, which is called as consciousness. Therefore, all of us can experience a consciousness now or not. Yes, The moment I know how to de-link the world, how to de-link the world from sense organs, how to de-link the sense organs from the mind, how to de-link the mind from the consciousness. This is the process, this is the knowledge which is given by the Veda and very beautifully brought about in this lovely text called Vigdrishya Viveka. I finished the first topic. We have another 15 minutes to go, so I will continue the second topic. This section 6 to 12 deals with how is this mind formed, what is the origination of the sense organs, the mind, and how they function, what are the activities of the three spheres. We'll study in detail. Sakshi means a consciousness. It is never formed, it is always is. That means it is not created. The world is created. Mind is created. Mind is created in the sense it is born, it can also go away. When we get the knowledge, we are not linked to the mind. Therefore, we can say that I am that Sakshi which is ever there, but it is not connected to the mind. Illumination of Sakshi is not an action in time, but it is its nature. For example, fire. The fire principle, the heat of the fire is its nature. The light of the fire is its nature. So there is no, it is not an action, it is nature. Similarly, consciousness illumines the mind. It is awareness principle which illumines the mind, and the mind illumines the sense organs. This is how it works. So it is beginningless, it is endless. That means I am eternal principle, immortal. Whereas the body, if I keep on looking at my body and saying, oh, I'm getting old, you know, then we'll feel miserable. But if you say I am consciousness, every day you get up in the morning and say I am wonderful consciousness, awareness principle, and that is a knowledge I got from the Vedas. And I believe in it. Therefore, I am ever free from the mind, I am ever free from the qualities of the body. This is the knowledge which helps us. What is the mind? The mind, people who have done Tattva Bodha with me know very well, the mind is made up of the Sattva Guna of the five elements. The five elements, each of them have got Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Sattva, Rajas and Tamas is there in all the five elements. So the Sattvic aspect, which is Sattva, Rajas and Tamas, belongs to Maya. So this entire chart of Tattva Bodha, you should have it right before you. You should know that Maya consists of three principles, Sattva, Rajas and Tamas. Sattva stands for the knowledge portion. Rajas stands for the action. Tamas stands for the resting, inertia portion. So the mind is inert by nature. It is made up of the gunas. It is subtle. It is not known to others, but only known to me. It's invisible material, as it is a material aspect like energy. It can't independently experience anything. The mind by itself cannot experience. It has to have the power of consciousness. How mind becomes the seer? I have explained this to you in the previous verses. I've said in a full moon night, it's the sun which gets reflected on the moon, and the moon reflects, moon illumines the earth. Now that is an example, drishtanta. Now comes to darshtanta, which is the actual fact. What happens is, awareness consciousness is a seer number one. Like the sun. The mind is like the moon. Mind is moody. It is matter principle. So it borrows a life from the consciousness. It is made up of five elements, subtle elements. Then the sense organs, they borrow the light, like the mind borrowing the light from awareness, consciousness, the sense organs, they borrow from the mind. Then what happens? The world of objects is seen by the sense organs. The world of objects is another realm of matter. It is gross objects, gross elements. Therefore, there is a different order of reality. Between the gross world and the subtle mind, there is a different order of reality. Between the subtle mind and the Karana Shariram, which is the seed form for the mind, there is another realm of reality, which is the sleep. So you can see the gross is the waking state when we are identified with the physical body. Then the second realm is the dream state when we are identified with the subtle mind. A deeper level is the seed state, is a seed for the waking and the dream. So that seed state is the ignorant state. When I don't know the Atma, then that is called as the Karana Sharira. And that is a subtlest matter. That's all. Nothing beyond that is matter. The seed form is called as Maya or Prakriti or Avidya. These are all different words which are used to explain to us this Karana Shariram. The end of the matter principle. It is the end with reference to the world also, with reference to this body also. So this is just a quick revision of Tattva Bodha. Mind has got, in this, slowly the author is going to tell us about ego I and the other aspects, that like the memory and so on. He will differentiate the mind into two parts. One part of the mind remains in the body, the substance part, the bottom portion remains. The vritti part, the top portion, they go out. And then what happens is they go and envelop the object, and then they reveal the object to us. This is how the mind functions. Epistemology, this is the science of knowledge. This is what is taught in that science. How the mind, how knowledge happens in the mind. So, Dakshinamurti Stotram is the central stotram. For those who have done Dakshinamurti with me, the 10 verses, you will remember this verse which we have done before. Nana chitra ghato darasti tadha ma deepak prabhabhaswaram. Like consciousness is like a lamp in the body. This consciousness illumines the mind. The mind illumines the sense organs, and then it illumines the entire world. So the portion which travels outside is basically the vrittis, the thoughts. Then the world manifests in waking and becomes unmanifest in sleep. It's the mind which sleeps. Then, just to show you here, the battery in a torchlight, you know, the consciousness is a sentient, it is invisible, it is transcendental, it is beyond the battery. Mind is like a battery, it is invisible. You cannot see the brand of the battery by looking at the torchlight. Eyes, ears, nose, tongue, skin are the beam of lights which go out from the torchlight, which is the mind. And then they go out to the sense objects, external objects. The external objects are inert by nature, but then they become sentient. They become sentient means they are known. They become known. they become known only by the light of this consciousness. So the next verse talks about the two aspects, the ego I and the mind. It's not the man, I made a mistake here, it's the mind. How is this, the mind and the ego, how does it appear? It's a very common teaching in the Upanishads. The mind is like a chaya. Chaya means shadow. It's a shadow of the consciousness. The intellect, the thoughts appear to be conscious on account of the reflection of consciousness. So the mind does not have consciousness by itself. It only gets the consciousness, it gets reflected. And then what happens? The thoughts is of two kinds. One is the ego I, and the second is the memory, intellect, and the emotions. All these three thoughts, they belong to one entity called as the ego I. So that is why the author is trying to give us a differentiation between I, the ahankara, and what is connected with that I. That I is the ahankara, which gets reflected immediately when you get up. But the memory, for example, suddenly I think about, during the day, I think about all the good times I had when I was a child. So this memory comes and goes. So these are the thoughts. So ego I is one type of a thought, but it is also a thought, but it is, you can differentiate between ahamkara and mamakara. Mamakara means my memory, my house, my relationships. So mind, intellect, memory, these are all my emotions. These are all mamakara. Ahamkara is the ego I. Mamakara is the mind, intellect, and memory. Now, how does this happen? In the next verse, he is going to talk about this example between the iron ball and the fire. I'll just explain to you here itself. See, what happens to an iron ball when it is put inside a fire? It looks red hot ball. Similarly, the mind, when it is bathed in consciousness, it becomes live, it becomes sentient, it becomes nourished, and then it can start seeing the world. The eyes and mind are incidental, but they don't. Therefore, we say don't get caught up with the eyes or with the mind. They are only incidental properties. They are not me. Body consciousness is not from the Atma, but from the mind. Consciousness, so that means the body comes after the mind. It is conscious, the body becomes conscious because of the mind. So the seer, number one, Atma, expresses as the mind and the body because of the sattva guna of the five elements or the tamo guna of the five elements. So the seer, that means the sense organs, are formed by the tamo guna of maya, and the mind is formed from the sattva guna. During death, what happens is the Atma, the seer I, is remaining there, but the mind leaves the body. The seer number two has left. When the seer number two has left the body, what happens to the body, the consciousness, what happens to the sense organs? The sense organs do not have the power anymore. Therefore, they become non-seer. They become inert like any other five elements. This condition of the body, where the sense organ, where the mind has left the body, is expressed in the Bhagavad Gita in one of the verses which we'll see. Two types of thoughts are there in the intellect, which is the one is the ego I, which is the dravya amsha, the substance called the mind, and the vritti amsha. Vritti amsha means part. It is the top portion, which is the conscious portion of the mind, like the emotions, the knowledge of the intellect. All these are only thoughts. This verse, the seventh verse, it goes a little bit deeper into this example of the iron ball and the fire. I will take this example, this seventh verse, we'll start next week because it's about 7 o'clock now. So I will stop with the sixth verse today and get on next week with the seventh verse, and then we'll continue the study of these Drigdrishya Viveka. So this aspect of functions of the three spheres will go on from verse number 6 to 12. And we will get a full idea of how this entire body, mind, sense organs, world, and consciousness, they all are related to one another and give us the experiences of joy or sorrow. Okay, now I'll go to the meditation portion.